But don't mistake our kindness for weakness.
All right, everybody, you are listening in right now to law enforcement leaders from the state of Minnesota assuring people that they are trying to keep the Twin City and surrounding areas safe as the trial for Derek Chauvin is expected to get underway on Monday. Again, he is the former Minneapolis police officer accused of killing George Floyd. He is being charged with second-degree murder and second-degree manslaughter. So we actually are being joined right now by Fox 9 Minneapolis's Kelly O'Connell. So I want to bring her up here on News Now from Fox. Good morning to you, Kelly. Thank you so much for joining us.
Good morning. Yeah, thank you for having me.
So, all right, we have a couple of top stories to talk about. Just to inform all of our News Nowers, this is going to be a weekly segment where we get the top stories, top information out of the Minneapolis area. And right now, Kelly, the big story is security preps as the Chauvin trial is just days away. So what are law enforcement agencies doing? We were just listening into a presser and they were talking about Operation Safety Net.
Yeah, so basically the concept is it's a tiered system to make sure that everyone involved in the trial will be safe, that the city will be safe, residents will be safe, but also giving the opportunity for people to protest peacefully, obviously trying to avoid what we saw here last summer. So kind of a tiered safety approach, and it will phase in as we get closer to trial and also more specifically closer to the reading of the verdict. So the idea is that there's going to be a lot of, safety precautions in place. You can see it right now if you go downtown Minneapolis. The government center was actually put on lockdown last night. It will remain that way until the foreseeable future, really. We know that there's fencing, barricades up around the courthouse itself, the government center, areas around downtown, but also the concept of figuring out a way to make there be a place for people to gather and peacefully protest. And that's kind of the balance. We are expecting an update once again today from officials. Essentially, we're getting updates almost daily or every other day about new things popping up to make sure that we are ready for what comes Monday and after jury selection as well.
And Kelly, we've heard that the FBI will actually be offering support to that area. What do we know about that?
Yeah, so the FBI has made it very clear they're here, all hands on deck. They've looked into possible, situations, possible threats. We know that they say at this point there's nothing specific that they're concerned about, but it's something they're monitoring. But we also know that everybody is monitoring it. Really, they've said all hands on deck from the FBI to the National Guard, obviously local police, but also officials and agencies from outside just the Twin Cities, kind of a statewide effort, if you will, to make sure that this is a safe trial.
And Kelly, the jury selection begins on March 8th, just a couple of days away. How will jurors be selected? I know it's going to be slightly different because of the pandemic.
Right. Obviously, that's going to put a different look on jury selection. So jury selection is set to begin on Monday. They say it's going to take probably about 3 weeks, or at least that's what they have scheduled for the time allotment for jury selection. We know that it's not going to be your typical jury selection. You can't have the pool just in one room next to each other because of COVID. So it's going to be a little bit different, and it sounds like it's going to be kind of more individualized, and they'll talk to potential jurors kind of one by one and figure out what that pool will look like. We do know that months ago, the county had put out basically a questionnaire to potential jurors, asking them how much they knew about the case, what they knew about the case, what they've seen on the news, if they participated in any of the marches or demonstrations in the summer. So trying to get an idea. Obviously, it's going to be near impossible to find someone who has no knowledge of the case and has never heard about it, but trying to figure out what that pool looks like. It's going to be different, obviously, in COVID time. We know the courtroom has been set up differently. They're only allowing a very limited number of people in the courtroom, and there's, barricades. There's also plexiglass in the courtroom itself. So it's going to be different, obviously, with COVID precautions.
And Kelly, my last question to you about this topic. Yesterday was a milestone moment. They passed the George Floyd Justice in Policing Act. It was approved late last night. So can you explain what this bill would do? And did you see a reaction from the community?
Yeah, so you mentioned obviously that happened last night. That's on the national level. And the idea is to essentially overhaul police policies nationwide, trying to make it more accountable, more accountability. The big topic out of that is it would ban chokeholds, obviously a huge topic of conversation, and ban qualified immunity for law enforcement. And it would kind of ease the requirements that a prosecutor would have when it comes to trying to pursue a charge against a member of law enforcement. Again, it happened last night, overnight. We do know that members of George Floyd's family was in Washington watching this unfold. We got a statement from their family attorney saying that they are pleased and consider this a major step forward in kind of reforming the relationship between police officers and the communities of color. We also heard from lawmakers here who say it's a step in the right direction.
Absolutely. Well, that is the latest on the Derek Chauvin trial security preps. Now, let's get to other top news in the area, Kelly. The latest on the vaccine rollout. I know Governor Tim Walz said that Minnesota is significantly beating his original timeline, and they're expecting the first Johnson & Johnson vaccines in the state. So what does the timeline currently prioritize? And, you know, what's the latest on vaccine distribution?
Yeah, so as it stands right now, Minnesota, we're at that level of 65 and older are eligible to receive the vaccine. And the governor had hoped to get 70% of our seniors vaccinated by the end of this month, and then he would open it up to the next tier. Well, the good news is that it looks like we're on track to beat that deadline of 70% at the end of this year. As of yesterday, 54% of the seniors here in Minnesota had received at least one dose. Now, the big question is, what will be that next round? And the governor has said he hasn't totally decided at this point. Initially, the timeline was going to open it up to workers at food processing plants and others with, you know, pre-existing conditions. Sounds like he might also be considering opening it up to 50 and older. Again, he hasn't decided on that, but at this point we're at 65 and older, and we know that the Johnson & Johnson vaccine just arrived here yesterday. In fact, they just opened it up. They opened up the boxes, calling it almost like Christmas morning, that we can really kind of get things going again and continue here in Minnesota.
Yeah, and Kelly, what do you know? We saw that pharmacies are actually redirecting, now that the Johnson & Johnson vaccine is here, the certain pharmacies are redirecting Pfizer and Moderna vaccines to parts of the state that are seeing some higher demand.
Yeah, so it's obviously a supply and demand, and there's been some spots where maybe they had a surplus of the vaccine, and so then they're pumping it into areas that maybe seniors were really longing for and feeling like it was taking a long time for them to get, you know, called in their line up into the line. So at this point, it's kind of a combination of all things. So you've got pharmacies. We do have that process working where pharmacies are working on it, but also just through your primary health, you know, your doctor, your physician, and also your healthcare clinic. And then we've had these kind of pop-up sites where we've kind of done mass vaccinations, if you will, for teachers and essential workers. And we heard from the state health department yesterday that, you know, if all of these systems are working together, they can do about 500,000 doses a week. So kind of using all of those systems at play and making sure that it's not just obviously in one area of the state, but surrounding areas.
Absolutely. All right. Well, the latest on vaccine rollout. Okay, now, Kelly, we've got one more top story to talk about. This has got to be my favorite. I'm actually going to switch your graphic right here. So we're hearing of a group called the Submergence. Now, we keep track of your temperatures out there in Minnesota. It's still really cold, but this group of people is apparently planning on taking some dips in the lake. I think they already have.
Yeah, it's cold for you. It's not cold for us here. This is like a heat wave for us. We're welcoming spring, but yes, I know it's all relative compared to other parts of the country, but this is crazy. So it's a group of people. It's about 40 or so. Every morning, they jump into a frozen lake. It's a lake in Minneapolis, not far from the downtown core. And they do this. It started kind of at the start of the pandemic, and they did it kind of as a way to just embrace our winter. You know, you got to do it here in Minnesota because it's here for a long time, so you might as well figure out a way to enjoy it. So they jump in the morning. They say it really helps them kind of jumpstart their day. They say it helps them kind of clear their mind and just be okay with the fact that winter takes a long time here. They jump in, they stay in that frozen water for anywhere from 3 to 10 minutes. It started out kind of a small group of friends, and then, you know, news started to spread on social media. People would be walking the lake and think, what are these people doing? I want to jump in. And now they've got a solid group of folks that do it. They, you know, strangers, neighbors, some do it in the morning, some do it in the afternoon, and some people finish their evening and do it at sunset and just hop in. And you know, I haven't done it, but, you know, to each their own.
Well, if you do it, I hope you have a photog with you, because we're going to need to see that. But I think that they're saying this. Some people who are doing it are saying that there's actually positive effects that jumping into this cold water can have on the body.
Yeah, that's what they say. They say it's good for them, and they also say, again, it helps them wake up. I mean, you know, some people do coffee, some people jump into a frozen lake. Whatever works.
Whatever works. Well, Kelly O'Connell with Fox 9 Minneapolis, thank you so much for joining us for these weekly updates on top stories. We're very excited to continue doing this with your team.
Yeah, my pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. Well, everybody, a huge thank you to Kelly and all of the reporters and anchors across the nation who are the reason that we are able to bring you the latest on the top stories and headlines happening. So very exciting, very times here on News Now from Fox. You're taking a live look over New York City over our Fox News.